Hello, I'm Carol Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's the bench.
And here's me.
There's not always a bench. That's a metaphor.
Here we go.
That's stupid. This is kind of fun. I'd like to welcome my guest, the great Carlo Curley. Carlo, you are an incredible organist, and I have to admit that it was you who got me hooked on the organ many, many years ago at the Alexandra Palace.
Yes, I am knocked out by that, because as I was thinking when you told me the other day, it's not yesterday. It's been a wee while since we were both there. You were in your teens, and I wasn't. We'll leave that right there and leave the viewers to suppose the ages.
You've played all over the world. I mean, it must be hard to narrow down a few favorite organs, but would...
It's a very legitimate question.
Yeah.
Favorites? Oh, gosh. Well, of course, there's the great Wanamaker Store organ, which is Macy's Center City, now that Kurt Mangel and his dedicated team of loyal, virtuoso service people have come in there and transformed that organ from night to day. I mean, it's you know, the building's been restored. There's now 2 or 3 seconds of reverberation bloom in the space. It's really going great guns. Another great organ that I love is the great Skinner organ at Girard College in Philadelphia. I was very closely aligned there and taught there for a couple of years and knew the organ and went there at the behest of Virgil Fox, who had recorded on that organ. He considered it one of the great romantic organs of the world. Oh, there's many. I mean, Westminster Cathedral in London is a stunning instrument designed by Dupre. Mm-hmm. Westminster Abbey, I love in many ways. I prefer it in the softer registers. There's much mystery in the Abbey organ. Mm-hmm. Oh, for the accompanying of psalms and things. It's pretty well without peer in the world. It's pretty stunning. But if I just think there's many. St. John the Divine and the Cathedral of St. John the Divine in New York has an organ which is just being restored now and will be back in a few months' time, so I understand. And I played a major recital in their Virgil Fox Memorial recital, and I will never forget the soft lighting, and there was a snowstorm and a sleet storm going on outside, and it was all uplighting and indirect lighting, and it looked almost pagan. You know, there was like a mist in the place, mm-hmm. and the place, you can never fill it, because I think it seats about 3 million, you know, but mm-hmm. the crossing and the choir was full, a very appreciative crowd, and something happened that night. It's one of the best programs I've ever played. Something went from the organ, from the force of that instrument into my hands and feet and head, and I just forgot the audience was there and just played for myself, really. Mm-hmm. And it was just, people were coming up and say, "Whoo, what did you take? You know, well, we want some of those tablets." You know, I said, "Well, I just love the instrument, you know." I'm thinking the Mormon Tabernacle, of course, and the Tabernacle is a stunning instrument. And of course, your own stunning Austin at Balboa Park in mm-hmm. San Diego is one of the most unique. I mean, it really, in a way, should be in England, because it's eccentric. It's an eccentric thing. And most eccentricity lives and breeds in the United Kingdom. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's people like Fawlty Towers, Basil Fawlty, John Cleese, yes. and all these people, you know, who you can't imagine them being American somehow. You just can't. Mm-hmm. And you would think that it would just be the sort of thing that the English would have sort of in every town as an organ pavilion, mm-hmm. you know, but it's here and it looks stunning. The sound of the instrument is amazing. And the full organ and the bloom of how it can build and mm-hmm. how you find the magic and handle the audience and stuff is sheer terrific.
Thank you.
And I enjoy it. As you know, I've been just there today in this marvelous heat coming from England and jet lagged out of my mind. But outside of that, don't worry, gentle readers, I am alive. There's more fight in the boy yet, more pluck to come. Don't worry.
Do you have a favorite composer? That's a hard one, isn't it, for a musician?
Geez. Well, you played two or three compositions today that are sudden favorites. One or two of them I'd never heard of before. Mm. You know, as I told a gentleman that was sitting next to me, I said, boy, I've got to come here, hear more. I'll get more ideas on programming. I said, this is, I'm sitting there making notes. You know, I said, I've got to look this stuff up, you know, especially the little hymn setting. Mm. Oh, that was to die for. Mm. I actually like some of the Messiaen. I mean, yeah. People have a giggle. I think the Hindemith sonatas are fantastic. Yeah. I play all the Bach trio sonatas are just divine. I mean, and I just don't say that because they're taxing and they're difficult to play. There's some beautiful, absolutely stunning writing. It's the major Bach pieces, a lot of Buxtehude I play. It is 300th year, of course, now, the anniversary of his death. Wagner transcriptions I adore to play. I've made a point over the years of taking beautiful melodies that can melt stone if called upon so to do, and just trying to do what J. Stuart Archer and some of the great the great organists like Lemaire and so forth have done, of being able to take just a simple, almost innocuous melody and just surround it with this sexy, you know, wonderful, milky counterpoint and great chords. And audiences love that, especially if they can go out whistling a tune to something they've heard that they know. You don't have to patronize them, of course, but it is nice that you give them a little of what they like, you know, and I've always been a great believer in that. I mean, Horowitz did. If he played piano recitals, which I went to many times at Carnegie Hall, what got them going? Sure, they loved the Scriabin, they loved the Rachmaninoff, they loved the Beethoven, they loved the Bach Busoni, they loved all those things, but the Stars and Stripes Forever, which sounded like four people were playing, was the one encore that got them so agitated that it caught their smalls on fire. You know, they were screaming, it made a rock concert look like a prayer meeting, you know, and to think classic music can do that.
You've heard some of the great legends. You knew Sir George Thorburn Ball. You studied with him.
Very well, for a long time.
Tell us a little bit about him.
Well, everything had to do with singing. George, in a way like Virgil, but he more so, linked everything he did at the keyboard to the human voice. Everything was a song. It didn't matter. And I think he got that from Walford Davis, his predecessor at the Temple and with whom he studied. And he once said everything that Walford Davis touched turned into song, whether it was piano, strings, you know, it didn't matter. It was meant to be sung. Mm. And it was at Virgil Fox's behest that I went to work with Thalben. It's too long a story for here. I mean, but to make a short story longer, in a nutshell, Virgil introduced us, gave me a lovely letter. Thalben welcomed me very warmly, and I'll never forget. I played something terribly fast. I thought I would impress him. I was a teenager, and I went and got the stops and used his pistons and built up to full organ and something. He played in a very un-English way, a very undignified way, you know, a very scurrilous way, I think is how some English cathedral organists would call it. And Thalben gave me all this rope, and he kept nodding, and he was sitting there in the quite a portly man, you know, and go on, marvelous, marvelous, you know, and at the end, and the sweat was flying everywhere. Carol, I was, you know, I thought, oh my God. And I thought, I've got him. Oh, he'll think that's canny. Oh, that's good playing. You know, he said, Carlo, my dear. So he called everybody my dear, whether they were 5 or 500. He said, the first thing you'll learn when we work together, he says, the first rule of organ playing is very simple. He said, never, ever show everything in the shop window all at once. And, you know, have you ever felt deflated, Carol? I mean, as someone sort of went and just pulled the cork out, and you just sort of went, You know, I thought, we became good friends as well as having a fine student-teacher relationship. And I learned as much from watching him conduct the Temple Choir on those sectional and the full rehearsals on a Friday evening, I believe they were. And he sang, the singing at the Temple was heavenly. It was like, there are many fine choir trainers in England, but George Thalben Ball was the doyen from that era or any era. They can all say, Wilcox is glorious, David Hill is brilliant, you know, they're terrific musicians, but Thalben had a magic. There was just something, as a friend in the southern part of the United States would say, the arm of the Lord was surely around him because he did it all from the soul, you know. Mm. And when he played the organ, it was, everything corresponded. The swell box manipulation, if a phrase started, the box was closed. He would open that box just like you were singing it, and as the phrase came to an end, he would taper. He used to call it dovetailing. Mm-hmm. Oh, it was dovetail that, Carlo. Mm-hmm. Or he'd say, I played the Nimrod for him once, some beautiful arrangement. He said, oh, it mustn't be too respectful, Carlo. The piece will come off the rails. Not too respectful. And that sort of thing, you know. And so I think what Virgil, I came as a sort of a mad kid who could play anything at any speed in virtually any key. And I mean, and Thalben really just honed it, you know, and said, start playing more musically, make it sing. Don't make it an amusement park. It isn't, you know, this is really great music you're playing. And he taught me how to listen more than anything else. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Carlo Curley, thank you very much for
joining us. I don't have an opinion on anything, Carol. I hope you're able to see that, dear. Well, thanks for what you do, and good luck to you here.
You're terrific, and we are delighted that you've joined us this afternoon. Thank you.